Sunny 95.
Welcome to The Reasons We Smile with Dr. Kavitko, the show that brings you man-on-the-street interviews, celebrity guests, groundbreaking research, and heartwarming stories about the reasons we smile. Our show is also known as everything you've always wanted to know about dentistry, but we're too numb to ask. Hello, I'm General Dentist Dr. Kavitko, and thank you for joining me today.
The following views and opinions do not necessarily reflect those of this station, its staff, management, or parent company. To hear a replay of this show or one of the great shows that previously aired, log on to thereasonswesmile.com or iTunes, keyword Dr. Kavitko or The Reasons We Smile. Listeners should not use Dr. Kavitko's comments and advice in place of an actual dental exam.
Brighten your life with a smile that shows the professional touch of Dr. Kavitko.
Time now for The Reasons We Smile with Dr. Kavitko. Call 459-9769 to discuss your dental issues. Now, here's your host, Dr. Kavitko.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to The Reasons We Smile. I'm Dr. Kavitko. This is episode number 162. Thank you so much for joining me. Before we get started, 562. I wrote that wrong. I just shortchanged myself by about 400 episodes. Thanks to my producer for catching that. I'll have to change that. Anyway, yeah, 562. Okay. Hey, before we get started, I want to wish my daughter Mindy and her new husband Jim a wonderful life. I mentioned that last week as well. They're getting back from their honeymoon today, so hopefully I will see them. Thanks to everyone who came, and to we hope that everyone had a great time. So, yeah. It's a wonderful, what was a wonderful day and a wonderful event. Okay, so before we get started, I'm going to remind you that if you want to follow me on Twitter, it's at Dr. Kavitko. And if you'd please go to my office Facebook page and like us, that would be awesome. All episodes, complete with video, are available at thereasonswesmile.com. And we're streaming live on Facebook, so I'll give a little wave to the Facebook camera there. All right. Today's show is entitled, During the Various Dental Procedures I Perform, What is my brain saying to my hands? And why does that matter? Okay? So, anyway, yeah, it's an interesting thing, and I'll tell you how this came about. One of my dental assistants is training now to be an EFTA. Stands for Expanded Functions Dental Auxiliary. Not dental assistant, I used to think it stood for that. It stands for dental auxiliary, because they're more than just an assistant, and in fact, they don't assist me at all, other than they actually are trained and certified to place restorations after I have prepared the tooth. And that's why it's called auxiliary rather than assistant. So at class, she was talking to some of the people, and I think even the instructors, and she learned that a lot of EFTAs, is what we call them, go on to become, she didn't have the name right, but she was saying how it's kind of a pathway to becoming this new model, this new thing that people are talking about called a dental therapist. And it's not, you know, psychiatric therapy. It's I don't know why they came up with that name, but we've talked about it on the show before, and somebody came up with the idea that in areas where you don't have enough access to care, if you train somebody to be able to do some procedures and you stick them out 100 miles away from everything and have them monitored by a dentist somehow from 100 miles away, that they could extract teeth and they could drill teeth and fill teeth. So that got me talking, and it got me telling her that why I think that is such a bad idea. And I was explaining it to her, and I thought, you know what, I'll explain it to everyone today. So, we all know that as adults, whenever we're doing something, my producer, he's controlling this board. So when you're going to make your phone call to win the flowers in about 10 minutes, which I guess I didn't mention, in about 10 minutes you're going to have a chance to win flowers from the DeSantis Florist. Okay, and you'll be calling 614-459-9769. So, when that phone rings, he's got to get your call. He's got to make sure that you're not on the air too soon. He's got to make sure that the microphone's still working for me and that everything goes smooth. So his brain is talking to his hands. Well, that doesn't happen as a 15-year-old. 15-year-olds couldn't do this job. 18-year-olds maybe not could do this job. But at some point, people understand that I have to be constantly thinking and constantly doing the right thing so that everything goes smoothly. Well, the dental therapist model, the plan is to have people get about 2 years worth of training out of high school, so potentially you could have a 19-year-old doing it or a 20-year-old doing it. Extracting your teeth, drilling on your teeth. People that aren't trained to do root canals, supposedly just trained to take out decay and place restorations. Okay, so let's talk about a couple of the things that, you know, when a patient sits down in the chair, and by the way, this is besides the point of making sure that they're comfortable with me. Am I presenting myself properly? Do they understand that I care about their health? Yes, I understand this costs money, but there are things that we just have to do in life, because if you don't, you're going to be in pain, you're going to lose a tooth, you're going to this and that. So beyond that, I have to think to myself, I'm getting ready to numb this person. We're going to be working on their upper right second molar, for example. So I pick up the topical anesthetic and I spray it in the area. But before I do that, I turn back and I look at the x-ray and I look at my chart and I look at our list. Is this the right tooth? Am I doing the right tooth? That's a very basic question, but it's very important. You all know in the hospital now, when somebody goes in for surgery, they'll take a black magic marker and they'll mark that leg, right? They'll mark that arm. They ask the person, what are you here for? I'm here to have surgery on my right arm. If they say left arm and the right arm's marked, they have a problem. They have to sort it out. So I'm looking back, making sure I have the right tooth, because I don't want to numb the wrong side. So then I spray the spray. We wait a few minutes, let it do its job. Then I pick up my anesthetic. Is the anesthetic outdated? Did I let it get? Is it expired? Is it the right one? Does it have epinephrine? And this person shouldn't have epinephrine. Am I numbing the correct area? And so the other thing I'm doing is, when I'm putting the needle in, there are things I have to keep in mind. One is, first of all, you're always trying to aim to the right spot. The right spot is this area. There's this little bony projection called the lingula on the inside of a mandible, kind of in between your tongue and the outside of your face. And there is a nerve, the inferior alveolar nerve, and it goes into the mandibular canal, and it disappears into that canal right by the lingula. Well, that's where I have to get a person numb, because the bone's so thick that if I just deposit the solution next to it, it won't go through and the person won't have a numb tooth. So I have to get as close as I can to that area to get the person numb. So I'm thinking to myself, okay, this person's there, 6'9", they've got a bigger jaw, probably have to go a little bit more lateral, maybe a little deeper than if I had a 100-pound young lady in the chair. That was much smaller, and all of this is happening and you don't even know it. In fact, while this is happening, what am I saying? You're doing great. This shouldn't be too bad, you know, just kind of stay real still. We're going to get you real numb. I'm talking to you as though I'm not even thinking about the other things, but I'm thinking about the other things. My brain is talking to my hand while my mouth is talking to you. There's a lot that goes on. Okay, and guess what? If I get really close to the nerve, if I actually touch it, that's like, man, I hit the target. Right on the nose, right? I'm having a great day. Wrong. You know why? Because if I touch the nerve, you get a zing, like an electric shock in your lip. Makes me look out to be like I'm a terrible dentist. Can't even give a shot without hurting you. You know? So those kinds of things in just the very basic beginning of an appointment. Then, once I get you numb, and we always wait, and by the way, not everybody gets numb the first try. We put the solution right where we're supposed to, but there are individual anomalies. They're what we call common anomalies, where this person has a nerve that might be a half inch over from the next person, or a quarter inch, or it makes a left turn there instead of a right turn, and it's all invisible. We know where it should be from when we are in dental school and we actually dissect humans, the cadaver lab, so we can see these nerves. But there's still this individual variation, and the anatomy books will show common anomalies. So commonly, there are people that don't match that pattern. Okay, so now I'm going to be drilling your tooth, right? Well, while I'm doing that, the first thing I'm thinking of is, am I using enough water? Because if I have the right amount of water, it keeps your tooth cool. If I don't use water at all, your tooth gets too hot, I could kill the nerve and you might need a root canal. That was my fault. Okay, so I have to make sure there's just enough water to keep it cool, but not so much that you're drowning. And I can guarantee you, the only one you're going to notice is, oh, that's too much water. It keeps going down my throat. And I have to think about your comfort, and yet I also have to think about your tooth. So enough water. Am I drilling too close to the nerve? Okay, there's only so many millimeters between the outside of your tooth and the inside, what I like to jokingly call the creamy filling, which is where the nerve and the blood vessels are. And so if I'm not paying attention or I don't know enough about what I'm doing, and that's what they teach us in dental school, if I drill too deep, well now, again, we've popped into the nerve, you're not going to feel it because you're numb, but you're going to need a root canal that you would not have needed. So we have to be very careful. We take out the old restoration with the drill, but then, many of you know this because you're my patients, but then what happens is I take my hand instruments and I slowly scrape away the soft tooth decay, because if I'm careful, even on one that's just like paper thin between me and the nerve, I'm not going to go into that nerve center again. You're not going to need a root canal that you would not have needed. And remember what I said about the dental therapist? They don't know how to do root canals. They're not certified to do them. So if they drill too deep, I guess they're going to just look at the patient and say, guess we have to extract your tooth. You may never know why, but this person's going to lose a tooth because the person working on them is not qualified or trained to do a root canal. And I would argue they're probably not trained to properly extract a tooth or fill a tooth in that time frame. Okay, so now, so that's a very important thing. The next thing that I want you to know about is, okay, the drill's moving. It moves at 430,000 RPM. 430,000 revolutions per minute. And it's a carbide burr or a diamond burr. It'll cut almost anything. It'll cut metal, right? And by the way, as soon as I touch it to your tooth, it slows down. But it doesn't slow down much. It slows down to 120,000 RPM. It's still spinning 120,000 revolutions per minute. All right, so why does that matter? Because what if you swallow while I'm drilling? Well, now your tongue comes up and it rubs up against the side of this moving drill. So as I'm drilling, I have to be thinking, what if this person swallows? What if they move their tongue? What if they go to talk? And I have to be ready for that. So that means my other hand has to be holding your tongue aside with my mirror, or my assistant has to be holding it aside with the mirror, or something, to make sure that in the event that you swallow or go to talk or just plain move your tongue, that I'm not going to drill the next tooth, one we're not working on, doesn't need it. I'm not going to drill your cheek. I'm not going to drill your tongue. Okay? This might be making you kind of nervous now that I think about it, and I'm sorry about that. But these are the kind of things that you should be thinking about when you hear about the dental therapist model, how it's the answer to all answers. And if you're a legislator listening, it's a terrible idea, and you wouldn't want to have somebody like that working in your mouth, so you shouldn't approve other patients to be worked on by those people. Not that they're not nice people. I'm sure they're nice people. Don't get me wrong. You just have to have more training. Okay, so I'm getting the sign that it is time for us to do Dr. Kavitka's question of the day. And remember, you're going to have a chance to win free flowers from DeSantis Florist. And all you have to do is remember what we just said. Some of the things that my brain is telling my hand is the patient numb enough? Am I drilling too close to the nerve of your tooth? What happens if your tongue moves right now and hits my hand? What is holding the drill? All right, before we do the contest, we'd like you to listen to this.
This station will not be held liable for any contesting during The Reasons We Smile with Dr. Kavitko. Participation in the contest allows Dr. Kavitko to record and broadcast your name and call. One winner per household. Prizes are non-transferable, cannot be substituted, and are subject to taxes and fees. This station cannot be responsible for the inability to enter the contest, whether due to equipment malfunction or telephone difficulties. All decisions of Dr. Kavitko concerning this contest or eligibility are final.
And now it's time for Dr. Kavitko's question of the day.
All right, and the question of the day is, during the various dental procedures I perform, what are some of the things that my brain might be saying to my hands? A, is my patient numb enough? B, am I drilling too close to the nerve of your tooth? C, what if your tongue moves right now and hits my hand that is holding the drill? Or D, all of the above. All right, the winner receives free flowers from DeSantis Florist. They'll be delivered to your place of business this Tuesday afternoon. The number to call is 614-459-9769. That's 614-459-9769. So go ahead and call now.
You won't believe it though. I want to hear your mind. And there's nothing else in the world tonight. She said people don't take the time. Hey, people don't take the time.
Hi, I'm Keith Carlos, winner of America's Next Top Model and star of Chocolate City 2. Look for my smile on the big screen this summer, courtesy of Dr. Kavitko. Stay tuned to The Reasons We Smile with Dr. Kavitko, the world's most interesting dentist.
Hi, I'm Dr. Kavitko, general dentist and host of The Reasons We Smile radio and roadshow. Did you know that you no longer need to visit several different dental professionals to get more complete dental care? We handle everything from cleanings and orthodontics to restoration, implants, and smile makeovers, all in my office. And now we have two locations. Get the most advanced technology and procedures available today. It's more complete dentistry.
Visit worldsmostinterestingdentist.com for more info about Dr. Kvitko.
Dr. Kvitko, let's go!
Yeah!
Hi, this is Richard Simmons. Dr. Kvitko's here, and he's going to help you with all of your problems. Are your teeth yellow? He can fix that. Are you missing a tooth? He can put a new one in. How is that?
That's very good. Thank you, Richard. Okay, we're back. We're doing Dr. Kvitko's question of the day. We have our caller, our winner on the line, and my producer said he has the correct answer. And so, hey, Hemen, how are you today?
I'm doing good.
Good, good. Thank you so much for listening and for calling in. What is the correct answer?
All of the above.
All of the above is right. Hey, what do you do for a living, Hemen?
I'm a pharmacist myself.
Awesome, awesome. Yeah. Does this surprise you all? I mean, you have to do this in your job. You're always thinking about these various things, aren't you?
Yeah, you always have to multitask. Like, you know, your brain is thinking differently, and you're talking to someone, and you answering something differently. Yeah.
Right, yes, you're being nice to the customer, so to speak.
That's
and,
right.
And then in the meantime, you're thinking, okay, got to make sure we get the right compound, the right drug, how does it interact with the other drugs this patient is taking, right?
That is correct.
Yeah. So, hey, thanks for calling in. Please stay on the line, because we need to get the information where we can send you those flowers, okay?
Sounds good. Thank you.
Okay, you're welcome. Bye-bye. Okay, so if you're just joining us, I'm Dr. Kvitko. This is episode number 562. And today, the title of today's show is, during the various dental procedures I perform, what is my brain saying to my hands, and why does it matter? Okay, so we covered three of them at the very beginning of the show, and now we're going to go on to some others. So when I am doing, here's an interesting one. I like this one. I'm gonna go with extraction next, because this is a little bit about dental therapists, that whole model. And so we're not even done with the fillings part. Let's do fillings first, because I started talking about the drill and how you don't know what you're doing. You get into the nerve. So now you have, let's say that the tooth is prepared, all the decay has been removed, and now it's time to put a filling in. Well, that's not even that simple. Okay, if it's real close to the nerve, there are medicaments that we want to put in the tooth first to protect the nerve. After those go in, then we have to put a sealer in there, and then after we put the sealer in, then we have to put a band around a tooth. If we're doing silver, it's a metal band, and it has to be snugly up against the tooth, especially up in between the other teeth, you know, and we have to wedge that in there. If we have a gap there, then the filling material oozes out below, and you have what we call an overhang, which then collects food and debris and essentially causes a new cavity in another year or two. And then once we have that band on and it's been wedged and everything is good, then we have to pack the material in. So in the case of a silver filling, which people still do, and they still teach the aftus, by the way, because they need to know how to do both. We'll talk about the tooth-colored filling in a minute. So the silver goes in, and it has to be packed in very tightly. And now you have what we call the proximal boxes and the marginal ridges, and the edges. And so you have to trim away the extra silver before it hardens, and then you have to adjust the biting surface to make it one that if the person bites down, it's not going to break, because if it hits too soon or too hard, it's going to just crack, because that filling material doesn't harden right away. It doesn't harden for about 24 hours. And so that all has to be trimmed, and you have to do it in a way that the person can chew well, and that they can the flossing goes through properly, that it's not too loose, not too tight. And all the while, we're assuring the patient of how you're doing great. You're doing great, John. We're almost done, you know? And they don't know what you're thinking about. You don't know all of that stuff. And you shouldn't need to be honest. Although I would worry about, again, a dental therapist who I would worry about their training and knowledge and expertise. So after we get that the silver filling all kind of in there and kind of what we think is trimmed, then we have to take the band off. Take the wedges out, take the band off, and do some more trimming. If you're not careful, you can pull off some of the filling when the band comes out. And if you do, you have to kind of start over. So we get it trimmed, and then we check it with the marking paper, the checking the occlusion, and make sure that's all set. Now, tooth-colored filling, which is a whole different animal, is very hard to do. It really is, for everyone involved. dentists, F does everyone. Because when you put that in, and again, you're going to put a band, and there are special bands for this, because tooth-colored filling, when you push on it, it's like pushing on pudding. You can't, or jello, you can't compress it. You just can set it in there. Oh, and here's a big one, especially for leftists listening and for dentists listening, if you haven't already figured this out. When you go to put a tooth-colored filling in a tooth, let's say it's a huge cavity, I know that if I just fill up the hole, shine the light on it to make it hard, that tooth's going to be sore from that day forward, and you're not going to know why. You're not going to figure it out because the bite's going to be perfect. There was no crack in the tooth. There's no abscess, but the people keep complaining about soreness in that tooth. Why? Because that material shrinks when we shine the light on it. So if you just put a hole, you just fill it up completely and shine the light, well, you've created internal stress in there as that stuff shrinks and it's attached to the outside and inside of the tooth and is yanking on those cusps. So when you're doing tooth colored, you know, and again, even if the person says, I got to leave in 5 minutes, I can't hurry through this. I have to put some of the filling material on the, say, the right wall and cure it from the right. And then I have to put some on the left wall and cure it from the left so that, excuse me, the it's basically sucking the material up against the outside wall and the inside wall. And then the very last thing I do is I put some more material in the very middle to fill up the missing part. And that way I don't create that internal stress, because you have to do it in layers, in increments, just a little bit to build it up. Otherwise you build up, you basically make a tooth that's going to be sore. Okay, and then we have to take the band off, and then we have to get it adjusted. But because that is hard, we have to use our drill again. And so people thought, oh man, I thought they were done drilling. Well, yeah, we were, but now we're kind of, I call it sanding, but it still sounds like the same thing, to get it all adjusted. And sometimes with those ones, because you can't push on it, if you didn't wedge it properly or use the right band, well, now when you put the floss through, it doesn't touch anything. It just falls in there. Guess what? If we stop there and say, hey, you're done, John, you know, hey, see you next week, now food's going to fall in there, and it's going to be a constant problem for you because it's going to be this food trap, all because of us not getting the contact properly tight. So then what we should do if that happens, and we do, is we take a little of that filling away, get the drill out again, drill out some more, put another wedge in there, put another band in there, reverse order, of course, and fill it to where you can have a tight flossing contact. So people think fillings just kind of happen. You know, they're not as easy as they sound. We make them seem easy, but it's not as easy as you think, and getting them right is a trick. And it takes a lot of time and effort and expertise, and even EFTAs will tell you how long it took them to get to the point where they were comfortable placing them and could do it on a regular basis, where when the dentist comes in and says, hey, great, looks good, floss is great, bite's good, looks nice, you got the right color. Because that's another thing. If you put the wrong color in, accidentally, we've got to take that out too, right? You don't want like a brown tooth when you have white. You don't want a white tooth when you have brown. Okay, I'm getting the sign that it's time to go to another break. You're listening to The Reasons We Smile with Dr. Kavitko, episode number 562, and we'll be right back.
You can't take me as I am. Just a little bit. I don't know who to be. I'm a paper cup, baby, of the sea. I know you see it too, 'cause you're too much for me.
This is Clark Kellogg. Stay tuned for more of Dr. Kavitko.
Estás escuchando con Dr. Kavitko aquí en su estación favorita.
Hi, I'm Dominique Reigert. Like what you hear? Why not use the show to promote your product or service by becoming a sponsor? Call 614-262-9588 to learn how. That's 614-262-9588. Call now.
Hi, I'm Dr. Kavitko, general dentist and host of The Reasons We Smile radio and roadshow. I've been honored to help several famous people get a perfect smile, like Keith Carlos and Dominique Reigert from America's Next Top Model, and Ted the Golden Voice Williams from right here in Columbus. Isn't it time you had a celebrity smile? It costs less than you might think, and most of the time, it can be done in one visit. A new smile can make a world of difference.
Visit worldsmostinterestingdentist.com for more info about Dr. Kavitko.
I'm Grandpa, and I go to Dr. Kavitko, and I still have all my teeth. Real ones. Where's my glasses?
We're we're back. I'm Dr. Kvitko. This is The Reasons We Smile. It's episode number 562. Thank you so much for joining me. I really appreciate it. Today, we are talking about, well, the title of the show is, during the various dental procedures which I perform, what is my brain saying to my hands and why does it matter? Okay, so I mentioned that the genesis of this is the dental therapist model, which I completely disagree with and think it's dangerous. And so the other function they are allowed to perform is extracting teeth. So when I'm extracting a tooth, what is my brain saying to my hand? One of the things is, again, did I get the tooth numb enough? And by the way, that's not as easy as it seems, because a lot of these teeth that need extractions, they have infection. And when there's an infection, the anesthetic doesn't always work the same, especially if it's going into the infected area. And so you can't just assume because a person has a numb lip and a numb tongue that their tooth is numb enough. And I hear story after story after story from you guys about how you were at a dentist and they numbed you up, but you weren't numb enough, and that you told them you weren't numb enough, and they kept working. We don't do that, by the way, even if it puts us behind. And so the first thing that I do, I'm making sure, am I numbing the right tooth? Am I getting it completely numb on all sides, palate side, the cheek side? And sometimes you have to do what's called a periodontal ligament device injection. I don't know if they teach that to the dental therapists. I really don't. And that means putting anesthetic right around the tooth and gum and forcing it into the area there. And then I'm also looking at my x-ray, which is typically behind me. And I'll turn around and I'll look and I'll see, now what shape is this root? How rotten is it? Is there anything solid that I can grab onto? And if the root has a curve on it, then I have to roll that root out to that direction. If it's dilacerated, if the two roots and they go in opposite directions, well now before I even go to pull that tooth, I know in advance that I'm going to have to cut that tooth in half and take it out as two halves, one that goes to the right, one that goes to the left. Because if I try to take it out as a whole, it's simply just going to break off. It just will. And then I have to worry about, is the person on blood thinners? All right. Do I need a stitch? Do I need to, am I going to have to take away bone? Am I going to have to suction this tooth more than once? And all the while assuring the patient that everything is fine and, you know, you don't feel anything, do you? We're doing great. You're doing great. So it's a lot. And now that I've kind of started tackling this topic, I'm seeing that there's plenty more. We might even come back to this on another show down the road, but I'm also seeing that the clock is telling me that I'm done. I'm just plain done. So, hey, thank you so much for tuning in. Let me just say that that's all the time we have today. Don't forget to follow me on Twitter at Dr. Kvitko and visit my office Facebook page and like us. It's Dr. Kvitko and Associates. Remember that all past episodes, complete with video, are available at thereasonswesmile.com. Be sure to tune in next week and every week right here on your favorite station. Goodbye.
This is Carly Red from Love & Hip Hop Atlanta, the hit show on VH1, urging you to tune in next week with my dentist, Dr. Kvitko.
If you're interested in learning more about this and other dental health topics, go to thereasonswesmile.com to access full episodes of Dr. Kvitko's show.
If you'd like Dr. Kvitko, the world's most interesting dentist, to speak at your next event, please call 614-262-9588. That's 614-262-9588 or send an email to speaking@thereasonswesmile.com.